I don't have a lecture here, so I will talk. It works in the recent past, I've been really scalable. It's always been Facebook. It's almost 1 billion users by September 2012. It's 1 billion users. Then if you see Google Plus, or if you see, Twitter, they reach much faster, TikTok, 150 million subscribers. Much faster. Google Plus reaches, say, less than 1.5 to 2 years. Right? So the scalability of this virality of this application, I think, is very good. But only the idea is to be socially connected. This is socially connected. I've connected with my friends, with office colleagues, with the people I know, or who people I want to know. And then I can probably exchange emails, or exchange my friendships, or exchange my status, and so on. But there's no underlying theme of politics behind it. Right? So even with this, background, these apps have been really scalable for almost whatever 1 billion users. Right? So can we have something which will help current users? For example, Bangalore is ripe for a lot of protests here for a lot of people are coming out in the open, right? So, but not more people are there who are silent, they support silently, and then they don't come out in the open. A lot of people also don't vote, right? And there are a lot of myths around it. So I'm going to talk about some myths here in a little bit. And then see why people don't vote, why people are anti-politics, apolitical, and so on. But also I've analyzed some parties, political parties in the past. If you see, the quickest political party to be successful is Bahujan Samaj Party. Quickest. I say quickest, it took 20 years for them to reach power on their vote. The only exception is Telugu Desam Party. And they took only 9 months to reach power. But that's an exception. The exception is a lot of other factors that helped them. But if you see from Brownswell, collecting people drop by drop into the people has been Bahujan Samaj Party. So that is the quickest. So India has 70 crore voters. 70 crore voters. This is as per the Election Commission of India listing, 2011-2012. And then we have, I think in the 2014 general election, we had somewhere around 85 crore voters. Out of 70 crore voters, only around 55% vote. So 45 crore vote, right? So out of 45 crore, if you see Congress vote share, they get 28% vote share across India. So that means they get 50 crore votes. And many of them, they don't win also. So they are second in position or third in position. So 15 crore votes, which many of them in the losing cause, they can get you 210 MP seats today. Right? So just 15 crore users. And they are of course spread across both villages and urban areas. Right? So this is the fact. So 15 crore votes can decide a majority. And what is the problem there? There are 500 ministers in India, across all states, across all unions, territories, and the center. 500 ministers. They get to rule India. If the 500 ministers report even fewer bosses. So it's imagining like one Sonia Gandhi, one Rahul Gandhi, who can decide entire thing for the entire country. And can they listen to all the people's problems? They don't have time to listen. It's not scalable at all. Can 500 ministers listen to all the people's problems? It's not scalable. Even Bangalore, if you say, so that there will be at least 1 lakh problems. Can the ministers or MLAs listen? In fact, I talked to at least some of the candidates who are standing on behalf of Lok Sabha and even Aam Aadmi Party. They are trying to do best by word of mouth. They are talking, okay, can you get me water cards? Can you get me this and that? It's not scalable at all. How many people will help with water cards? How many people will help with ration cards? So many problems are there. So today's model is breaking up because, one, we have very limited powers of authority. It's a very limited, there are only 500 ministers. There's no power delegation. We may have, recall there's a panchayat module, there's a municipality module, but believe me, they don't get any funds. Research shows that they get only 2% of the funds that India gets in the taxes. They always look up for chief ministers to allocate taxes, to allocate funds in their budgets. And you have to be good with chief ministers. If you're not good with chief ministers, you're not getting your funds for your municipalities and your panchayats. So these 2% of the funds that go to the panchayats and municipalities, again, they don't have a say of what they want to use it for. They won't have a say. They say, okay, use it for MNREGA. Use it for this. Use it for Siksha Yojana. But they may want to build a school. They may not be allowed to build a school with this funds. So that's how the power is then not delegated in India. Right? So Because with these problems, it leads to a lot of eruptions. Sometimes you may have pressure walls where people come out and protest. We want governance, we want better this, we want better that. Right? So this is all pressure walls coming out and saying that, yeah, things are not going well for me. So, and also, if you see a lot of, for example, farmers is one thing where a lot of problems are there. Right? I don't get to produce what I want to produce. I don't get to sell at the price I want to sell. I don't get to buy the fertilizers and seeds I want to buy it at. Right? So everything is predetermined and I get only to do what I am supposed to do. Right? So that's why there's a lot of farmers' resistance. And sometimes the poor is so poor that even they're getting even poorer, that they go to nationalism. They actually, they are motivated to actually go and fight against the government. And that's why they join Nazi force. Right? So I'm not saying that it's a good thing, but they don't have a choice. Many people say that they don't have a choice. Right? So the rich have become the richer. You can see the Ambani's building. It's much 1.1 billion or whatever it is in the cost. And the anger, when we go to join the candidate protest first time, you may see some 1 lakh people there. Okay, great. We have good feel good environment there. A lot of people are coming out to protest. Okay, nothing happens. Next week again, you go there, nothing happens. Third week, you go there, 1 lakh becomes 50,000 people, and then slowly it builds up. Right? So, what is the solution people say? Okay, go out and vote. Does it really help? Going out and voting helps? Everybody say go out and vote. If you see all the national media campaigns, go out and vote, it will change the problem. So actually there are only 3 choices. If you like the current government, you vote the current government then. If you don't like the current government, you will see who has the best strength to vote the current government out. So you vote the major opposition. You not vote for any third guy or fourth guy. Because you don't want to waste your vote. Right? Or third choice is basically you don't do anything. Everybody is a chore. Right? So I'd rather see that form as well. So there's a myth is that going out and voting in the change system is not going to help. So it's not going to help at all because you only have 3 choices. Now, again, why would I think that it's a waste? Because see, I get a chance to give my feedback once in 5 years, which is a rare event. This is the only feedback that the person gives. It's a very rare event. And unless I challenge my energies, I need to talk really at least 4,000 people, 5,000 people or whatever, and then say, get this guy out or get this guy in. Unless I do that, and people don't actually come out to open and say, okay, let's challenge my energy, unless you are a political party. So people don't go out. That's why people don't want to waste their vote. So only one chance in 5 years. For example, if I'm angry with BJP in Karnataka, I need to vote either Congress in or JDS in. I'll say who has better power, better chance to win. So if JDS has better chance to win, I'm going to vote for BJP. If Congress has better chance to win, I'm going to vote for Congress. Even though Lok Sabha is standing, I don't think many people will vote. It's my personal opinion. But then, see, again, everybody is, this is the psychology of thinking of voting. So voting is not going to solve your problem. That's myth number one. Myth number two, right? Anyway, we have Panchayati Raj Act, we have RTA Act, so we have all these things up there. So it's going to solve the problem, right? Panchayati, it's a good thing that Rajiv Gandhi did, that by Panchayati Raj Act, he actually legalized the Panchayati. Like Panchayati was not legal, Panchayati were not legalized. Right? So, but what is still not happening is, they didn't pass the 63 and 64 amendments in the Constitution, which will actually give power to the Panchayats. Right? So they only passed the 71, 72 amendments, but they didn't pass other amendments. Because obviously actually the Panchayat Raj still are, they go seek blessings from Madam Jayalalitha, they go seek blessings from Shetter, whoever it is. Unless you are friendly with your state government, you will not get your funds. So that's why most of the urban local bodies or even rural local bodies elections, the incumbent who was in power in the state wins all the time. Right? So, what if we people want? Again, I'm not affiliated with any political party, by disclaimer, right? So I'm not affiliated with any political party. What do we people want? We want people to actually react like any private person does, right? If I don't like a product, I go give it back to it replace. Or if I no, better school, say, if I go to a, say, I want to get my license done in the RTO office, they should give me a process of how to do it, at least. They should give me a phone, pay the token money there, or whatever it is, he's there, and then do a test, or whatever. Nobody is doing that. Even though there are charters out there, we say the complaint to this guy, complaint to this guy. Unless you pay the bribe, or unless there are two options. You go pay the bribe, or you go to the agent, or you go and knock the doors at least 10 times if they yield. And actually, the yield also. It's not that they take a bribe all the time on the board. Right? So the yield also. So coming back, what do we people want? Right? We people want services from the government like we have, we get services from the private agencies. And if you don't like the services, we want an alternate option also. And there should be some competition. For example, postal was a monopoly. Now there are no private postal services. Are you able to any private postal services? There's no monopoly there. Right? So similarly, there was a lot of private telephone systems. Now there's no private telephone systems. It's an important one. And there was a bribe even in actually from the tickets in your Irish. We used to put in the long book blocks where you had to go and you say, okay, I want a ticket from say Bangalore to say Mysore. They need to write it in blocks. And for that, you need to pay bribe. So there's no bribe in ticketing system. Very difficult. Now, at least there's some bribes in the Tatkali, what I hear. But a lot of things have been removed. So we want a non-monopoly service. We want an aggregated service called, for example, Bangalore one. If you go to Bangalore one, you can actually do some services that you want from government without actually paying rents, right? So that's an aggregator of services, of government services. Sakala is another thing. It's another example of how you can actually not pay a bribe and get some services from Bangalore. Sakala is just grab an anybody and say that I want to get my Tata Center transfer that's going to get that. They'll give you a process and they'll give you timeline also, right? So this is something which are working well for the economy, for the politics. So we want the structure of services across everything. I want it fast. Can I go to a court and get justice today? No. I'm an educated person. Right? I'm legally aware. I'm not a lawyer, but I'm legally aware of the process. If I am actually sound off, I can check my lawyer. I have the ability to check my lawyer. And then say, and then even after that, if I want to get a justice to the system, I have to wait for at least 10 years. 10 years is lucky actually. If you go to civil court, maybe even 20 years. There's no justice available in this country through the legal process. Right, so what you end up doing is you end up doing reconciliation outside of the judicial system. So no matter the poor person in urban rural India. Yeah. So I'm talking correct. So I'm talking about what we want. I'll talk about the mix also and then solution also. Right? So this again for this. Right? So yeah, so I was talking about this. So take 10 years, 15 years, even for example, this is what happens in urban India. Imagine it's right in rural India. He's uneducated, he doesn't know, he goes to the police station. There the person gets raped if you go to the police station because the police guy normally is friendly with your richest farmer in the village. He doesn't want to antagonize the richest farmer in the village. Why? Because the richest farmer in the village is politically connected. All the rich farmers in the villages are politically connected. You can take it. All the rich farmers in the villages are politically connected. They know a political person in the village. Right? So they don't want to antagonize anybody there. So that's why the people don't even register their FIRs from the UCC complaints. And then, even if you want to get a bail, a poor person has to pay 5,000 rupees. For him, he will not get a bail. How will he get it? He can't pay 5,000 rupees to get a bail. Whereas, we can be rich enough to get a bail. Right? So the poor people, there's no justice at all in this country. And we can actually say it's a bandage for people. Because you want to actually go and reconcile. That's why Netflix demand we have federal courts. You don't want to go through the normal judicial system because there's no judicial system. I'm not getting a ticket from BJP. But you people, organizing you people, we people will only vote for the number one, number two guy. We will not vote for number three, number four guys. Right? Because we want to wait, waste your vote. So always, the good people are not given a helping hand to be pulled up by the leading parties today. So the good people are there to protest all the time. So the barrier is basically the good people, what is putting the good people down is the number one, number two barrier. I would call this the leading party barrier. So unless you become a dominant force by yourself, all the good people become dominant force by yourself, nobody is going to recognize them, right? So and this is myth number two, right? So let me write on the website. They put another law, say that anti-defection law, so you know house trading. Today, house trading is completely reduced, right? Unless you get a sizable chunk to defect, you cannot house trade, right? So that's, again, it's a stupid law, I would say. Why? Because actually, if you are good, everybody is good, people should be left to their conscience to actually vote for different of the party, right? They should be left to their conscience to vote, right? Now, if Congress passed a diktat saying that everybody should vote for this thing, there was a rule, and everybody should vote. If somebody doesn't vote, he actually can be expelled from party. That's not a good thing. But I may not like, for example, FD and retail as a congressman. I should be allowed to vote against FD and retail. Right? So, but if I vote against FD and retail, I'll expel from party. That's a bad thing, actually. But it has prevented cross trading, but that is not the solution, actually. So,
myth number three is poor or
what?
And unemployed.
Actually, bought is a good word. You know, if you're bought from poor, you become rich. So, may not be bought.
No, bought means they are given, say, one bottle of liquor. That's what people say, no? 500. Nowadays, even Tamil Nadu, if you see the by-elections and all.
That's what misled.
No, they were bought. That's what they say, right? It's a myth. See, I'm telling you, people are the number one. In a village, there are only two parties. They're not the third party. In a village, there are only two parties. Right? So, there are only two forces there. So they assess. The leader of the village assesses if he's from one party. He assesses. What is the hava, what is the climate? Will people vote for the incumbent or will be voted out? Right? Will they vote for Congress or will they vote for BJP? They know that, the leader of the village will know that. And they spend money based on that. It's not that they actually spend 5,000 rupees for every vote they buy. They don't. So there is they assess their own stuff. Based on assessment, they'll think, okay, I don't need to spend any money to win this time elections. And sometimes they don't even spend any money. They get money from the top. They don't spend any money at all. Right? So it's as if every village head makes an assessment himself. That is, understand how much money you spend in the buying votes. And then the people in the village, when I say people in the village, the people who are bought, normally are Dalits, or normally who are people who don't have a means to for themselves, right? So they're not bought actually. They take the money, but still they vote for the persons they want to vote, right? They take the money from both the parties. Okay, for example, if it is BJP and JDS, they take money from both the guys. Okay, I'll vote for you. But they actually vote for somebody who they want to vote, right? They're not unintelligent, they are intelligent. Right? Don't have this myth saying that poor are the problem for the country. No, they are not the problem for the country. They are as thinking as we are. Right? They are as thinking as we are. Okay. Other myth is politics is a full-time career. Okay, if somebody says join politics, people say, what are you mad? Right? Politics is not a full-time career. It's probably, if you are, what is political? Is it caring for somebody, caring for a neighbor, or caring for a friend of yours? Right? If somebody says, okay, yeah, this police big, this guy is here. Right? So, yeah, so it's a complaint. Going along with your friend to actually find a complaint. That is politics. Right? So, it can be as simple as that. Or it can be even as big as, okay, yeah, I'll join a political movement. But I'm not quitting my job for that, right? I need to get money. How will I feed my family? I'm not quitting my job, but I'm joining a political movement. I'm joining probably, say, whatever, Lok Sabha or Aam Aadmi or BJP or Congress or whatever, right? So I'm not quitting my job. Job is a full-time thing. What will I do if I join the political party? Hey, probably it's for the government. Or you actually help the party by contributing to the idea of solution. So I know that, for example, the RTA value is not implemented, or Lok Ayukta is not done. Or there is an RDA commissioner appointment in London, so you probably help file a complaint, or you help file an RDA query, or you actually say, okay, a traffic problem with this particular road, can you solve this particular problem? Solution. Right? So simple caring like this is what is politics. And probably you can get 10 more people to join a party. Right? So only in your neighborhood, only 10 people in a matter of 1 year, or one person in a week, getting somebody to join a particular party, that can be political. So politics is never a full-time career. See, Prime Minister is president is the highest paid person in India. His salary is 1.25 to 1.5 lakh. Many of us in IT get more money than that. Many of us. And he's the highest paid. And imagine that normal worker or even a chief minister. You know how much salary they get paid? Sir, less than 1,000 rupees a month. And these, when they are in power. And imagine if they are not in power. How will they can make money? They can't feed their family, right? So you can't count on politics as a career. Politics is not for career. So don't join politics for career. You have to be part-time involvement.
So see, the thing is, what I'm guessing is, politics should be made as a career. So what is happening is, you'll have full-time kind of accountability also. See, right now what is happening is, they think they have totally different opinion about politics. Now, if you have a politician's kind of very, kind of make it as kind of corporate job, so they'll have more accountability. That's what I'm trying to say.
Okay, so today, as I said, right, we have 500 ministers in India.
Okay.
So you're saying increase their pay hikes. Give them pay, good pay.
No, the thing is,
how do you make them full time?
So, see, we are talking about pay hikes also. What I'm talking about also is about just give them more responsibility.
I'm telling the 500 ministers have a lot of power vested in them, but they don't use their power. They go, always go to Sonia Gandhi, they always go to Jayalalitha, they always go to the Yediyurappa to actually get their pounds on. They don't do it themselves. There are some people who are exceptions who actually think themselves, by example, Jairam Ramesh. He was acting independently on environment ministry, right? So now Jayanthi Natarajan is taking a cue from him and saying, okay, yeah, let me also not give all approvals for environment this way itself, right? So there are some independent people like that. Many people actually follow what the central leadership says. They have a lot of authority. In fact, I'm saying that authority has to be delegated down to the villages, to the municipalities, to the bank, to the local authorities. Right? So the responsibility is fully there. What I'm saying that can I count financially with politics as a career? No, because I can't make money if I'm honest. Right? I can't really feed my family if I'm honest.
Well, in terms of facilities, what government means to is way beyond your carpets.
Only for MPs, the facilities are lifetime. Right? Only for MPs. You can get a free train ticket, first class, AC, right? Forever in your lifetime. But most of the other posts, they are not lifetime. And today you can't make money, you can't make your family running in politics, if you're honest. You can't really make money. Okay, next thing is top down command only will work. Why? Because I fight with my colleague. Yeah. If I make a rule saying that if you are an Aam Aadmi party, you should not join us, that means they can be sued. They should not distinguish between a person who is politically active and who is not. Right? In fact, every country, if they do that, they can be sued really. The government can clamp down on them. What today happens is, okay, the only thing that we can change today is if I win a seat, for example, if I become an MLA, right, I should be allowed to be full-time dedicated to my MLA post for 5 years and then come back and join my job after that, right? So that is something not available today, right? If I quit my job and then become an MLA and then join, be an MLA for five years and then after 5 years, because I don't have money to actually feed my family, right? Then I can I go back to my job? Today, the employer will say no, right? Correct. So in governments today, I can take a 5-year break, sabbatical I can take, but I can't take in the corporates today. The corporates don't give that policy today. So that can be legalized only if the people who are thinking in politics are able to do it, right? So next myth is basically is top-down command only will work. Because we are all so much fighting, right? If I am in college, I fight with my classmates. I can't even do some college elections properly, how can I actually do something at a national level scale without fighting, right? Infighting will always be there. So I need top down, somebody like Sonia Gandhi to actually pull the angles. If two people are fighting, Sonia Gandhi should say, okay, you win, you lose, right? You be quiet. So top down command will only work is a myth. Why? Because today, that's again, forget Sonia Gandhi, right? If you are coming from bottom ups, right? So for example, if people say that I want Kaveri water for Bangalore. So no matter what, first preference always for drinking water to Bangalore and then only to farmers. Right? And then people get their MLAs sign on this agreement, saying that when you get elected from us, you have to implement Kaveri drinking water at 25% to Bangalore. And then the people below should actually remove it. Yediyurappa should not be removed by Nitin Gadkari. Yediyurappa should be removed by people below him. The MLA should revolt. If MLAs don't revolt, people who actually elected the MLA should revolt. They go to the MLA house, boss, what are you doing? Correct. So we are, this is a myth. Top down only will work is a myth today. Why? Because again, it leads to nepotism. Ultimately, this is something which leads to nepotism because of lack of time. If you say, Sonia Gandhi will not have time to listen to all the people, right? She will give appointments probably 1 year down the road. No, that's what. So the solution is basically there should be a solution, there should be a process, right? I'm not talking about, okay, everybody should be fighting among yourself, okay, people should come in there. There should be a process for it. There should be a method for it. I'm saying that there's a method for it. Right? So there should be bottom-up accountability and top-down accountability.
Situation, that is the way it works. When you think of any
Okay.
Does not come back to the solution part.
Yeah, I come to solution, but there are historical solutions in corporate world today where there is no top-down hierarchy. There are at least four companies I know in US, I forgot the names, who don't have any hierarchy in the system. Anybody can be anybody, right? Your salary will not be decided by, there's no boss there, right? Your salary will be decided by your colleagues based on how much output you give, right? So there are, it's working. So it can be possible, I come to solution. It's a method. So, I'll say solution. An open political network. Let me say open political network. We have Facebook, which is a social network. So, ideally, it should be a party, political party having this network. And, okay, it can be, it should be in online in urban centers. It should not be, it cannot be off online in rural India. And in fact, rural India will be the last person who join the train, right? So, here. They won't come, and they are very feudal. When I say feudal, they always respect the caste system, they respect the hierarchies in the village. So they will not allow you to actually break those hierarchies. It's not very easy. So if you see independence movement, you study independence movement also. It started only in Calcutta and Delhi. If you see, people did not want, really want independence apart from this two urban centers in India. Then even when Gandhi came, when Nehru and everybody said, okay, we want independence, he in fact said that, okay, who wants independence? Only a few people in urban centers. Because if you go to the villages, nobody really thought about independence. But they had problems. They had food supply problems, they had crop problems. So Gandhi toured India at least four or five times across India to actually work on the people issues. He never thought about independence when he came from South Africa to India. In fact, he said, you fight for independence, I'll not fight for independence at all. Right? So urban centers will be the always a focal point for revolutions to begin with, ideas to begin with. And they can be even questioned, they can be ridiculed at first, but this is where actually they had to carry along all other people outside. Right? So open political network is where the solution is. So what is this network about, right? It can start with 100 users in Bangalore. Right? If you see, water database is free. It's free, water database is free. You can actually download 70 crore users using a robo, but robo will get rejected after some time, so you have to delay the robo. You can download all the 70 crore users, identity, where they're staying, which booth they are attached to. So your identity is not secret anymore. Your identity, I can download anybody's identity here and then say, okay, this is the person who's living in this particular locality. 70 crores, right? All these are PDF files. This is downloaded. So I can create a 70 crore database. To begin with, but you don't want to, right? You want to actually compost it only in urban centers. So Bangalore, you can download that one for whatever database you want to have. Say, I think 15 lakhs people are there here, more voters. So start off with 100 users. Each one get one, or each one get five every month, right? So 100 can become, this virality concept can come in, and then say they can become, say, 5,000 people, right? So this is the each urban center can become like that. So now you classify this 5,000 people into three areas: MP constituency, MLA constituency, and local urban local body constituency. Now these are the, I know how many people are there. There are 27 MLA seats in Bangalore, right? So I know for each MLA seats how many people are there in the network for me. I will contest the elections only if, when I say I means this particular network will actually unlock. If you see Groupon concept, the Groupon concept says that, okay, only if there are 10 buyers coming in, only this discount applies, otherwise discount doesn't apply, right? So only if there are, say, 20, the last year's elections, I will say, number one, number two, I have, for each constituency, I have this data, by the way, right? Number one, number two. Number one, say 50,000 votes, number two is 25,000 votes. Right? So unless I reach this level, number two level, I will not contest. The network will not allow you to contest. So what will happen is this puts a pressure on the people. It puts a pressure on this 1,000, 5,000 people to actually get more people. Right? So now the pressure is on the candidate to go and get votes for himself. Like Lok Sabha guy is coming and saying that, okay, why don't you spend my word of mouth? It's on the candidate. And the candidate says, what will you do for me? Then he has to say, okay, I'll do something for you. And then it becomes a barter exchange, right? What will you do for me? I'll do something for you. Now again, it becomes some selfish motive will be there. Now, all these will be locked, 27 seats will be locked, and based on the threshold being lit, some of them will be unlocked, like the Groupon constant. So, say for example, 5 seats are unlocked today. Do I consent for five seats? No, I don't. Then there will be second level locking. There are totally 220 MLA seats in Bangalore. Unless I reach, say, 5% or 10% of all the seats unlocked, I will not contest the state. Why is this important? Right? People don't want to see you as a failure. If you contest once, and if you lose, if you're not a number one, number two, next time they don't want to waste your vote. Right? They'll see that they'll, okay, I'm not sure if Jay Prakash Narayan from Lok Sabha will lose Pukutpally seat next time he contested. I really have my doubts. Why? Because people think that, okay, anyway, he'll get only one MLA seat. What is the point of electing him? I'll not vote for him. Even the people like him, right? They'll not vote for him. I hope he wins, right? Because I think he is one of the best politicians that we have today. So, two-level locks will ensure that you're not seen as a failure. You actually spread your word of mouth, prepare your ground, prepare for exams, and then only when you're ready to take the exam, take the exam. It means waiting for 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, so be it. Right? Because people have to be ready for it. Right? This is a open political network concept. So, this is only one quantum component in it. Right? So then what is a manifesto? Do I need to, okay, I'm ready to contest. Do I actually release a manifesto? What is a manifesto? Manifesto is what people want. When you have a network, actually you can aggregate what people's demands are, because you actually, as a member of the party, you can say, this is what I want. When I say, this is not all the things. For example, I want water to my home. Simple. I want water to my home, I can say. That may be a problem. Somebody can identify a solution for it within the network. So I don't need to have the best thinking guy or the best brainer guy to be an MLA who can actually give all the solutions for me. The solutions and the problems can be identified from the network within itself. And for example, I can say, the police guy beat me, I want better accountability from police. Or somebody asks me, okay, I want better accountability from judges. Okay, what is the solution? Solution comes from people. Okay, one solution is, okay, you can say, I can scale the number of courts from 25 to 100. That is not going to solve. If you see, most of the solutions are come in terms of process improvements. Even today, for example, in court, simple solution is this. In the court, for me to get to the argument level, from the time I file a complaint to get to the argument level, there are at least 20 hearings. 20 hearings. And why should judge be there in the hearings? Judge is not required at all. Because he doesn't even listen to arguments till the point of time. Right? So if judge time is valuable, you make him he's the most valuable time. So remove him from the process where he's not required. That's simple, it will solve the problem. Right? So everything can be online. Okay, filing a complaint, then filing an affidavit, filing an evidence, everything can be online. And only when it comes to arguments, you can take time from judge and then say, okay, yeah, this is when I want to actually come there and do it. And then it can be done fast. It can be done in 3 months to 6 months. It's a process improvement. Correct. So that's that's why you said, what is this? This is the problem, solution solver problem is actually getting the right people elected. And then once you get the right people elected, get the power devolution to the people. Today there's heavy concentration of power at the center. Center gets 60 funds of all the taxes today. All the taxes collected in India, all the states put together, everything put together, center gets 60% of the funds today. And they are actually giving those funds to the states. Some of them, not all of them, some of them they are giving it. That's why Mamata Banerjee is saying that, give me funds. Modi says, give me funds. Right? And Chidambaram says, okay, I'm powerful, I'll give the funds to, if I like Nitish Kumar next election, I'll give funds to Nitish Kumar. Right? So why should center be so powerful? In terms of funds collection, in terms of even fund implementation. The center also says, in this village, use these funds for building this canal. Why should somebody in the planning commission, Montex and Oliver, say that this village needs a canal here? The people in the farmers decide that I need a canal there, or I need a school there. Right? So this is how it's too much of power aggregation in the center. So once you have the right people elected, this can take 20 years or 10 years, I don't know. Right? This is the idea.
The corporate world did not be the best right there.
Correct. So, for example, everybody says, kill that guy. Will you kill that guy?
Exactly.
Right? So, there are the individual votes. There are some priorities. You see, there are legal priorities that you take in the constitution today. First thing is, individual always counts. But individual counts to an extent that your fundamental rights are protected. So, the priority list is there. For example, everything is a law, right? Within the law, there are some priorities within the law. So, if somebody is getting killed, you have to prevent that guy killed. Right? Just because somebody is, say, Parsi, he should not be in a village, doesn't mean that he should not be in a village. Right? So the law should protect the individual rights. You see, Singapore has evolved this thing. They were in also a bit of flux when a lot of imitation happened from the West. Right? People want to be in the West, they want to wear Western clothes, they want to actually eat out junk food, everything. damage. No, I'm not talking about Singapore. See, for example, so this thing, if you want to.
We always compare Singapore, but what I mean is Singapore is a small.
No, I'm talking Singapore only for this individual right production. Because see.
Singapore is a financial hub.
No. Okay, let me give the context here. I'm not talking Singapore for this system here. I'm talking about Singapore for individual rights. So there, they belong to this Chinese thoughts, Buddhism thoughts, where the collectivism counts more than individual right. Okay, always collective is first compared to individual. Right? But even there, actually they said, okay, individual right counts. Right? I'm talking Singapore only for that. Okay, so this is this network which is not having presidents today. The only small presidents that I have today is Germany, where they started an online party called Pirate Party, and they won 8% of the city's Berlin's seats just before elections. They started this. It's not completely this idea, right? This has a lot of strategy components in it. It's not purely online application alone, right? For example, not contesting elections, really have the thresholds met. It's something is strategic in nature, right? Otherwise, you'd be seen as a radio. A lot of strategy components involved in this. Facebook took actually 6 years to reach 1 billion users. Out of the total population of 6 billion on the earth, right? So I'm just counting that when there is a catalyst available, if you have the app ready and if you have a political formation ready, then it has to matter of virality.
But the app and political system.
No. So that's why I said this is only online is only for urban today, and for offline it will not work. For rural it will not work. Rural it is basically very hierarchical in nature. There you have to have offline processes.
So, would your statistics prove that, like, say you said 1 crore people in Bangalore,
not Bangalore, basically.
How much of these people are,
So, for example, all urban centers today can get you close to around 70 to 80 MP seats in parliament. All urban centers alone. And believe me, because this is so fractured already today, that even 25 MP seats is going to be handful for you to get the power revolution.
Correct. That's
a good question.
It's easy to like something and comment.
Correct. So there are levels of membership. See, again, I'm not fully disclosing the complete thought in it. In fact, I wrote a book on this. I've not published it yet, but I gave it to two people who I thought were the best people today. One is the Jai Prakash Narayan, Lok Satta Party, other one is Arvind Kejriwal. And they are studying this. Right? So they are the best people who actually can implement this. Actually, Congress can implement it, but I'm not sure if they can actually go off the power. Because there's too much of power with their hands. I don't think if they'll be able to do it. Because people not vote for center separately and state separately. Today people vote for the regional parties, people who are present in the states. So ultimately central management aggregation of the states, right? So ultimately it will be more and more regional people. For example, there will be more and more defections. For example, Jagan party today in Andhra is a defection from Congress. There will be more defections. BJP also there will be more defections, like Yediyurappa defected. It's not possible to have one single party run across entire country like that without having defection for a period of time. So what I'm saying is, there will be power revolution from center to states, but what is happening is, even state is too powerful. Okay, and for example, Jayalalitha says that there will be water scheme for villages. She considered toilets for every village. Why is she wasting money for considering toilets for every village? I can build a school there if required. And the people in the village don't have any say at all. And these toilets don't have even water after 1 year. And they are not used at all. I'm not saying Jayalalitha is bad. I'm saying that the system is what keeping us from this point, right?
Do you think fixing the feedback mechanism would help?
Yeah. So what I'm saying is, one, collect people in the network. By being in the network, you're a member of this party itself. I'm assuming this is the party itself, right?
Because so you mentioned that voting itself is a mechanism of feedback.
Correct.
Anonymity counts. So when I have to go for
so people who are
vote, I have to write it down on that.
Correct. You
know what happened, I did for the demo? There were 15 to 20 pages where people had written, I don't know which to vote. And the next time the newspaper says only 3 people voted for coordinates.
Correct.
My vote is gone.
Correct.
So there is no anonymity and there is no...
Correct. So I'm saying that, see, in politics, your vote choice should be anonymous is what I believe, right? But you cannot be anonymous saying that, okay, do I support for Kaveri water to come to Bangalore or not? I cannot be anonymous about it.
Right.
Do I vote for a better court system in India? I cannot be anonymous about it, right? So I need to be part of a movement. If I'm part of a movement, I vote for the movement, right? So people who are part of the network are already part of the movement is what I'm saying. And by being part of the movement, if you decide to actually feel a candidate, by virtue, I need to vote for the candidate. So your question, coming back to your question, so all the people who are registered in this database or who are already volunteered on this database may not actually come and vote on the vote. Actually, it's true. Say, for example, 80% may be coming out to vote. There may be extra 20 people also who actually are not part of the system who can come out and vote for you, right? So they may not want to join this network. For their sake, they want to be actually on the last day, they want to decide and come and vote. They can do that also. So it actually evens out, right? So there are people who are part of the system who don't come out because I'm traveling to Bangalore today, or sorry, Chennai today. I'm not here to vote. I'm part of the network. But there some other people also who can say, yeah, let me see if Lok Sabha is going to win this. Right? For example, if it is Lok Sabha.
See, what I also observed when I moved, when I came to some districts from Tamil Nadu or Karnataka, I find the rural younger days have more accountability than the MLAs. Because what happens in the rural area is the people get to know the MLA very quick person.
Yeah. Exactly the same thing. Today, who is political in India? The rural India is political today. Urban India is so detached that they don't know anything. They don't know who to approach. If somebody approaches, they'll ask for money. And I'm telling you, if you go and approach an MLA, well, what's in it for me, he'll say. Right? So exactly, it's beautifully said here. Everything is relationship in a village today. The head of the village is the richest farmer in the village. Richest farmer in the village supports a guy who is a congressman or who is a BJP man. And everybody knows about it. Even though he may not be an official party member, he functions like an official party member, right? So village is very, very hierarchical, already pre-decided, except for the few hanging in balance votes in the village. They may be hanging in balance, that's why they buy votes, right? They try to buy votes, but still the guy who actually sold his, supposedly sold his vote, actually has not sold his vote. Right? He still votes by his own will, right? Once you get enough power, when you say enough power, so 50 MP seats is enough power, I would say. Or even in a state, if you have, say, 40-30 MLA seats, that's enough to actually support a lot of coalitions. Today in Karnataka, there are four-party politics, four parties. So in a four-party, to actually win a seat, you only need 20% vote share. It's easy to win a seat in Bangalore today, right? So earlier, I... Correct. Yeah, yeah. See, Aam Aadmi Party, if they contest elections without doing the groundwork, they lose. See, ultimately, wasting a vote is a predominant psychological factor. People don't want to waste their vote. Why? Because you're so angry with the current government that I want to displace it. If I want to displace Karunanidhi, who will I vote for? Will I vote for Lok Sabha in Chennai? I'll go and vote for Jayalalitha. Why? Because she has the highest possibility of defeating Karunanidhi. Or if I like Karunanidhi, I'd only vote for Karunanidhi. I'll not vote for Lok Sabha. So you'll fade out immediately from the political scene. So political scene is very, very competitive in nature. Very, very competitive in nature. If you don't play your tricks and cards right, you'll lose elections very, very easily. And that's why do you think Chiranjeevi went and joined Congress? Everybody thought he can win a CM post. Right? That's why he contested completely. He got 16. Next time people, knowing that everybody knows that he got only 16 last time, people will not even vote for the 16 seats next time. Right? It's aggregation. Aggregation happens. It's very competitive in nature. Votes are very competitive. That's why there are only place for two parties in a system. The third day, fourth, even though they can, I can have 25 contestants in an MLA seat, there are only two people actually. I said, no, it's a myth. Buying votes and liquor is a myth. You have to be number one, number two. The amount of money spent is not going to win your issues.
But today our government
is bad for it. Yeah, yeah. It has to be, again, there's a lot of thought gone into it. The best people who can do it is already political in nature, so I am approaching all the existing political parties with this. Right? So they have to build this app. So for example, we can build this also and give it to the existing political parties. See, I started a new one. I actually asked existing political parties to adopt, right? So I don't have any. I'm not sold my political leaning. So this is going to be a. If you see all the open source movements, Linux. Be it Linux or be it, no, I'm talking about anything, right? So who's authority for Linux? Who's authority for any software? It started off as a movement. There will be one principal guy who architected this particular software, but actually everybody owns it. So this particular software is not going to be decided by one guy sitting in the circle. That's why I said top-down command doesn't work. These processes, once we actually say, okay, this process is going to be good, everybody wants this process. You want to change the process? Within the party, so there. Within the party. No, there's no. This is going to be a party adopting the software. No, any party can adopt. See, this can be an open source software, right? With processors. Correct. If no political party adopts today, right? Even say Jay Prakash Narayan doesn't want to adopt. I don't know for whatever reasons. Or Amal Bhai Kejriwal doesn't want to adopt. People will say, okay, let's register this as a political party. The only difference is that you need to have 50 signed signatures to actually register your party.
Is there like a pledge
for
vote?
No, it's not pledge for vote.
Is it like a
campaign? Look, again, voting happens once in 5 years, right? I'm not talking about voting. I'm talking about what will you do in the rest of the period, right? So one, you may talk about problems, you may talk about solutions, you may talk about what your ministry should do in the next 3 months to 6 months, what you should they should do. Anything can be done. So there are. Let me answer that, right? So what I'm saying is, you have multiple components in this. One, your manifesto creation has to be done from people. And manifesto is not once in 5 years. It can be manifesto for the next 3 months to 6 months, right? It can be evolving also, right? That's one component is that. Other component is debates. Somebody will say FDA in retail is good, somebody will say FDA in retail is bad. So you want to put evidence why it is good, you want to put evidence why it is bad. So have the debates. Somebody will say Nexium is bad, somebody will say Nexium is good, solving your problems. Right? So in fact, if you see all the TV debates today, they are very, very skewed in nature. There's no expert who actually, even margin expert, there's no person who comes to the TV and then talks about it. But actually, it's very popular in some of the poor areas. There's no representation there. In a political network, anybody, anything can be represented. Somebody wants to give Azadi to Kashmir, they can discuss that. What's preventing you to discuss the Azadi in Kashmir? Right? So one is...
So somebody decides that FDA is good. Everybody decides FDA is good.
So the people who are elected by this forum, which is a political party, they are going to vote for FDA in retail, which may be only 25 MP seats in parliament. Right? See, again, it has to spread like this. What is the solution? Solution is, one, we should be preparing for contesting elections. Today, no party is preparing for contesting elections except for the number one, number two party. Right? And then, once you are ready to contest, then only contest. Then once you get enough people there to vote in your forums, what is a forum? A forum can be a MLA house, the state assembly, or it can be sent in the parliament. So then you have to vote. So if people who are joining this movement saying that everybody is saying that FDA and retail will vote for this, then the 25 people who got elected by this means should vote for FDA and retail. They should not decide. The people below in this network, they will decide.
But we have one problem. See, if people generally some stoppage, right?
Correct.
You can't just keep on doing it. They need their
them. I'm not saying there not be any person who has no responsibility. There will be people there. For example, I'm saying one of the rules in this particular thing is anybody has to quit their post after 2 terms. Right? Why it is required? Because people tend to iconize leaders in India. Right? Once you become a leader, we want Vajpayee back. Seriously, right? Everybody wants Vajpayee back. Had he not had health problems, he would have been again a prime minister candidate next year also. Right? We tend to iconize leaders very fast because we want them to actually continue. We have seen them working. They are actually solvers, problem solvers. They are actually the able administrators. Why let him let go of the person? Right? We want that back. So what is that preventing is at least nepotism. Third time you are a chief minister, again people form a coterie around it. They have accessibility. They are not approachable. They want form their own leaders. They run around themselves. And then it actually leads to worshipping people. Right? So to answer your question simply, there should be people with power. And the people with power should have the responsibility and authority to do it. I cannot say, okay, you are a receptionist, but you can't answer calls. How can I become a receptionist? You can't become a receptionist. A receptionist should have a power and responsibility to answer calls in the way that they are going to do. Right? But that's how it's all about. Today, why Indira Gandhi worked? Because the system is so constrained. So the center is so powerful. And if you have only authority, you don't need to work. Right? If you actually delegate the authority, I'm not saying that, okay, go to war in Pakistan should be decided by all panchayat leaders. No. For example, center should still have authority on with respect to performance, with respect to your rivers, water authority. Water is still with states today, to be frank. Water sharing can be with the center. Currency can be with center. There should be some powers which are identified with centers, some powers which are best delegated to the state, some powers which are best delegated at the municipality level. That's how it will work. I cannot hire somebody in CEO to be responsible for answering calls in the reception. No. They are still hierarchical in nature. A party person. No, today they contest elections based on what Jayaprakash Narayan decides. Jayaprakash Narayan decides, they will contest for 27 seats in Bangalore, he will decide. Who is the candidate, he will decide. Right? It is still a top-down hierarchical nature. And the manifesto is published by Lok Sabha for the coming ensuing elections. Why is the manifesto published by Lok Sabha? Right? And manifesto of Bangalore is published. So still they are not adopting this. Correct. So, no. They're they're not representatives. No, everybody can't vote on policies. Again, you aggregate the opinion, right? For example, again, I'm saying don't go to the... you can have a referendum module here. So, you cannot have a referendum for every small thing that you want to have. So, there should be a criteria for actually asking for a referendum, right? So, only if the criteria is met, then only you can say you can have a referendum. Otherwise, there will be too many frivolous things coming up for referendum. I'll say, then after that, you call it share. The third time will not go for a share, right? Because you already called share to promote center. Third time referendum comes, I'll not vote for referendum. So there should be a criteria for even asking for a referendum. And then only that criteria is met, then only the referendum will be there. So I'm saying that there will be people of responsible powers. But a party president should not decide the candidate. People, primaries, I'm talking about primaries here. In US, there's no one single guy who actually appoints Obama as a leader for the Republican or whatever, Democratic Party. It's the people below vote for him for a candidate. Right? So that's how it goes. So thank you.